So next, I want to talk about sarcopenia and body composition. So what is sarcopenia? Sarcopenia is low muscle mass. And if you look at the left-hand side, if you look where the purple line is, this is like normal muscle mass. Like if this whole thing was solid muscle from the purple line all the way around. Patients, as they get older, can lose muscle mass and with certain diseases, and maybe they would have some mild muscle loss, but they can also have severe muscle loss where in the blue, like that might be all the muscle they have, or the green would be like, sarcopenia, but not severe sarcopenia. And if you look at a cross section, this is like a cross section of the leg. And if you're looking at a healthy muscle, all the red is muscle mass. And then there's the body's, subcutaneous fat. In a sarcopenic patient, you can see that the muscle mass is very low. And because there's not that much muscle, it gets replaced by fat. If you look at the size of these two thighs, they're about the same. But the body composition is different because this has a lot more fat and a lot less muscle. And this is like a healthy muscle. And this is what a sarcopenic muscle looks like. And you can see that it's much smaller than a normal sized muscle. So sarcopenia is a sign of metabolic dysfunction and metabolic disease. It's common in patients with chronic diseases like diabetes, cancer, cardiovascular disease. It's common with aging. So somebody who's 95 is going to be more sarcopenic than somebody who's 25. And interestingly, it's independent of your body mass index. So you can be heavy and be sarcopenic, but you can also be skinny and be sarcopenic. You can have a low BMI and be sarcopenic. People that are sarcopenic have a higher chance of hospitalization, a higher chance of falling, and it's an independent predictor of overall mortality. On the right, I'm going to show you a couple ways to look at body composition. One way was we were looking at the thigh. But this is like two people that weigh the same amount. They weigh exactly the same. They're the same height. But if you look at their composition, this patient has 35% muscle mass, 15% body fat. This patient has 35% body fat and 15% muscle mass. Very different metabolically for that patient. So the causes of sarcopenia are variable. Inactivity is a very big one. Metabolic syndrome is another. Diabetes, poor diet, like if you have a low quality diet or inadequate caloric intake. Stress. Stress can really affect your metabolic health. Cancer and cancer therapies. People that have liver, heart, and kidney disorders. Genetics. Smoking and excessive alcohol. And I want to just show you two slides about sarcopenia and cancer patients. So this is a study done at Kaiser where they looked at patients who were diagnosed with breast cancer. And at diagnosis, before they were, treated or anything, a third of them were sarcopenic. And those patients that were sarcopenic had a worse overall survival. This curve on the bottom, the orange one, shows their overall survival was worse, independent of their BMI and independent of their treatment, the ones that had low muscle mass when they presented with their diagnosis. The same thing was seen in colon cancer patients, that patients that were sarcopenic had a lower overall survival. And this was also seen in patients whether they had high body fat or low body fat and high muscle or low muscle. And the patients that did the worst were the ones that had high body fat and low muscle mass. But the patients that had low muscle mass did worse than patients that were just heavy, had high body fat. So if you have high body fat, but you have muscle mass, that's more healthy metabolically. It's not just about how much you weigh or what you look like. It's actually what you're made of. It's what your composition of your body is. And this is another way to look at it. So this is a CAT scan slicing through the abdomen. These are two people with the same BMI, body mass index, which is a measure of your height and weight. A lot of doctors use BMI to decide if a person is heavy or not. is too heavy or obese. But BMI is an imperfect way to look at your body, because these two people have the very same BMI, but this patient has a lot of muscle mass. If you look at the red, that's muscle, and not as much adipose tissue in the visceral area. This patient has a lot of fat around their internal organs or visceral adipose tissue and less muscle mass. And interestingly, in their muscles that they have, they've got fat going through the muscle, a kind of like marbling of a steak. And this is also metabolically very unhealthy. And so intramuscular fat infiltration, which is what we just looked at in that previous slide, this is a slide looking at people's thighs. This is a sarcopenic patient. You can see that this person has way more mass, more muscle mass. This one has less. And the quality of the muscle is also lower, because this one has fat infiltrating throughout the muscle that they do have. So intramuscular fat can be a storage compartment for the body. For obese, insulin resistant, or diabetic patients, they can, in trying to get rid of the glucose in the blood, they can convert that glucose to fat and store it in the muscle or store it in the liver. And storing it in the muscle right here as a storage compartment is a way to deal with that, but it's also very unhealthy, because then there's a lot of inflammation in the muscle, and this can impair muscle function. Now, something that's interesting about intramuscular fat is that in exercise-trained individuals, there is some fat in the muscle that the body uses for energy, for endurance training, endurance exercise. But that's a rare, that's a more, that's for people that are very high-intensity endurance-trained athletes. But this is not a good thing to have, this intramuscular fat infiltration. So how do we affect body composition? And increase our muscle mass, and hopefully decrease our adiposity, which means our fat mass. But we really want to focus on how do we increase our muscle mass. Strength training increases lean muscle mass in relationship to fat mass. So it's going to increase your muscle mass the most of any type of exercise you can do. Aerobic exercise does help body composition by burning body fat, but it also does strengthen your muscles. Adequate nutrition, adequate but not excessive amounts of protein, avoiding fasting for more than 13 hours, stress reduction, because stress, if you're really stressed, like I mentioned earlier, your stress hormones get activated, and that can cause sarcopenia and muscle mass loss. And then adequate sleep is also really important for rest and repair of muscles. If you're strength training or you're exercising, you need to get adequate rest so your body can repair itself. And, you know, when we talked about free radicals and we were talking about how the antioxidants are made when you exercise in the cell, you need to rest for it to do the autophagy and the cleaning up of the damaged molecules. So rest is really important.